We have spent the last two lectures talking about the on-chain part of Plutus, the validation logic that is compiled to Plutus script and actually lives on the blockchain and then is executed by nodes that validate the transaction. And there's a lot more to say about that on-chain part. We haven't looked at more complex examples of validation yet that make more sophisticated use of the context and actually look at the inputs and outputs of the transaction. And we haven't seen how native tokens work yet. So Plutus script is also used to validate the minting and burning of native tokens. And we'll definitely have to talk about those topics and come back to that. However, before we go into too many sophisticated topics of on-chain validation, I don't want to neglect the off-chain part, because that's equally important. The on-chain part takes care of validation, but in order for there to be something to be validated, we must build these transactions and submit them to the blockchain. And that's what the off-chain part does. So I want to start talking about how to write off-chain Plutus code in this lecture. And unfortunately, there's a slight problem concerning the Haskell features needed. So the on-chain part that we have seen so far is somewhat alien and needs some time to get used to due to the fact that we have this compilation to Plutus script. But we don't really have to worry about that if we accept that there is this template Haskell magic. The validation function is just a plain Haskell function. And it's actually a very simple Haskell function from the technical point of view. We don't use any fancy Haskell features to write this function. And one of the reasons for that is the way Plutus compilation works. I explained that in principle, in these template Haskell quotes, we need to have everything, all the code inside these quotes. And we can get around that using this inline pragma, but that still means that everything we want to use, all the helper functions, combinators we want to use, must have this inline pragma. And because the standard Haskell libraries don't have it, we have the Plutus prelude, for example, that is like a copy or it's similar to the Haskell standard prelude. But it adds these inline pragmas to all the functions in there so that we can use them in validation code that gets compiled to Plutus script. But of course, there are hundreds of thousands of Haskell libraries out there, and most of them weren't written with Plutus in mind. So we can't use them inside validation. And that has the effect that the Haskell code inside validation will be relatively simple and not have many dependencies. So it's really just a plain old Haskell function. It gets these three arguments, the datum, the redeemer, and the context, and returns a Boolean. Or maybe a fourth argument if you parameterize your contract. And somehow in the off-chain part of Plutus, the situation is reversed. We don't have to worry about compilation. Nothing gets compiled to Plutus script. It's just Haskell. So we just write plain old Haskell in the off-chain part. But the flip side is that the way this is implemented, the way that works, uses much more sophisticated Haskell features, quite advanced Haskell features, so-called effect systems and streaming, and in particular monads. So all the wallet code, the off-chain code, is written in a special monad called the contract monad. And monads are very infamous in the Haskell world. They are normally the first stumbling block for beginners, for people that are new to Haskell. And there are a lot of tutorials out there that try to explain monads. Monads get compared to burritos and all sorts of metaphors to try to explain the concept. But I thought I should at least try to give a crash course in monad for those of you that are new to Haskell. And I do realize that that will be a bit boring for people that are already familiar with Haskell. But you can just skip ahead until I get to the actual contract monad that is relevant for the wallet. So I want to start with the a brief, quick introduction to Monads. Oh yeah, and one of you pointed out that my default terminal configuration with white on black is not very readable in the videos, so I changed that now. So that's why my screen looks different. And before I get to general monads, I want to start with I/O, so how I/O side effects are handled in Haskell. And before we get to Haskell, let's look at mainstream language like Java, and imagine we have a Java method with this signature here, with this signature, a Java method foo that doesn't take an argument and returns an int. And somewhere in the code later we use it, maybe we use it twice. So in Java, this call of the first call of foo and the second call of foo can very well result in different integers. Even though there is no argument, as long as we don't know what these dot dot dots do, we have no way of saying that this and this will result in the same. And why? Because in Java, it's perfectly possible that some I/O happens here inside the body of the foo method. For example, inside the body, there could be code that asks the user to input an integer on the console and then returns it. So if we call it here and then again here, maybe at those two occasions the user provides a different integer from the terminal and we get different results. And that also means that we really have to look at the code of this function in order to understand it or in order to reason about it, which makes testing, for example, more difficult. And it also means that, I mean, if we evaluate it here and, for example, get the result 13, we can't replace all other occurrences of foo, of invocation of foo with the number 13, because, as I said, maybe that's it wouldn't always result in 13. There can be something like console input here, or it could query a website or a database, for example, and that could change between different invocations of foo. Now, in Haskell, the situation is very different because Haskell is a pure functional language. So the equivalent signature in Haskell would be something like foo type int. And if then we have the same situation that we encounter foo twice, then I don't know what the value of foo is, but if, for example, I see that here it is 13, then I can be sure that here it will also be 13. And I don't have to look at the dots in order to know that. I don't care what happens here. I know that if I use the same thing twice, it will have the same value. And that's a very important feature that's called referential transparency, and that's a feature that Haskell has. I mean, actually, I'm lying, there are ways, there are like escape hatches to get around that, but we can ignore that. So the vast majority of Haskell programs, something like this will have a fixed value, and that value can never change, and you can rely on that fact. That, for example, makes refactoring very easy because I can just replace foo everywhere by 13, or I could do something like let x equals foo in, and then do the same code as before now with this local variable x, and I'm guaranteed that this term in line 15 and the term in line 14 will have exactly the same behavior semantics value. And that's this referential transparency. So that's a very nice feature. Very, it makes many things much nicer in Haskell than in other languages. Also, for example, testing, because it means if I have something like that, in order to test it, I must just check that it has the right value. This value can't change. So if I have, I mean, this is now not, it doesn't take any arguments, but if I had an argument, then I just have to, I know that if I plug in the, if I call foo with the same argument, I will always get the same result, which is not true in a Java function because side effects can happen. So that is very nice and all very well, but of course, you need side effects to have an effect on the world. Otherwise, all your program does is heat up the processor. So you need input and you need output. You must make things happen in the world. I mean, you must write results on the screen or read input from the terminal or from a network connection or from a file. If you can't do that, then your program is useless. It doesn't do anything. There's a famous video by Simon Peyton-Jones on YouTube. It's called Haskell is Useless. And that is about this thing that it's beautiful mathematically to have a pure side effect-free language, but eventually, in the end, you do need side effects to make anything happen. And of course, Haskell has a way to deal with side effects, and that is the so-called I/O type constructor or I/O monad. But don't worry about the monad right now. So the equivalent of something like that in Java in Haskell would be foo of type not int, but I/O int. So I/O is a type constructor that takes one argument, like maybe, for example. Maybe is another example of a type constructor with one argument, or list is yet another example. So I/O is one of these type constructors, and I/O is special in the sense that you can't implement it in the language itself, so it's a built-in primitive. And what does this mean? What does this type I/O int mean? It means this is a action or a recipe to compute an int, and this computation can invoke side effects. So you can think of it like a cooking recipe or a baking recipe. So it's like a list of instructions what the computer should do to end up with an int in the end as a result. So this type IO int is a computation that can have side effects and results in an int. However, it's important to notice that referential transparency is not broken with this I/O. So it's a recipe to produce an int, but when I evaluate this foo, the recipe won't be executed. And the result of the evaluation is just a recipe to produce an int, but there no execution is happening. So referential transparency is still maintained. And the only way to actually execute such a recipe, to execute an I/O action, is in a main program, in the executable, in the main entry point. So if you compile Haskell to an executable, if you have an executable, then similar to other languages, like Java, for example, there is a main function, and that actually gets executed by the Haskell runtime system. And there's another way, a second way, you can also do it in the REPL. So GHCI also allows you to execute I/O, so-called I/O actions. So the Hello World in Haskell looks like this. So you need a module called main, or in case of the main module, you can also skip the module header. And it must contain a function named main, and the type must be IO unit. So this is a recipe that can do some side effects, and in the end returns a unit, which means nothing. I mean, nothing of value, because there's only exactly one value of type unit. So the only interesting part are the side effects. And this would be Hello World in Haskell. Put stringline, I can ask for the type in my REPL. So the type of put stringline It is a function. It takes a string and returns an I/O action with no interesting result. So the type of put string line, sorry, hello world is I/O unit. So it's suitable for main program. And I can actually execute it, for example, with kabal run. Now, in my case, I called this hello, so that's specified in the kabal file. So it compiles and then it indeed has this side effect and writes hello world to the console. I should briefly show you the kabal file as well. So until now, in our previous examples, we only had this one stanza, the library stanza. So we were always just writing Haskell libraries without a main program, without an executable. Now I added this stanza here, this executable stanza, where I just specify the source directory and then which file contains the main module. So I called it hello HS. So here's an exception. Normally, Haskell modules always have to have, I mean, the file name must equal the module name. Executables are an exception. So the module name is always main, but the file can have a different name, like hello in this example. I also mentioned that another way to actually execute an I/O action is to do it in the REPL. So earlier I asked for the type of this expression, put string line hello world, but if I just enter it like that, then it will actually be executed in the REPL. So this hello world is the side effect happening while executing this I/O action. So we have one example of an I/O action or where to create one, namely this put string line. Let's look at another one. It's called get line, and that is of type I/O string. So that means it's a recipe, possibly containing side effects that, after having executed the side effects, will produce a string. And in the case of get line, the side effects in question is it will wait for user input from the keyboard. So if I execute get line in the REPL, now it waits for keyboard input, and if I enter something like Haskell and press enter, then I get the result, so the string result, which is the string Haskell. And there are, of course, a variety of I/O actions predefined in Haskell. And we now saw how to write to the console and read from the keyboard. And obviously, there are many, many actions to do all sorts of things that you would expect, like reading files, writing files, opening sockets, reading from sockets, and so on. But obviously, no matter how many predefined actions you have, that will never be enough if you want to achieve something complex. So there must be a way to combine these primitive provided I/O actions into bigger, more complex recipes. One thing we can do is make use of the functor instance of I/O. So if I ask for I/O, information on I/O, we see the dreaded Monad instance that I'm explaining now, but we also see a functor instance. Functor is a very important type class in Haskell, and it in principle only has this one method that's important. I mean, this one, the second one, is just for convenience. So if you have a functor type constructor, then you can turn FA into an FB if you have a function from A to B. So we are now only interested in the case where F is I/O. So if we specialize this to I/O, we see that using FMAP and given a function from A to B, we can turn an IOA into an IOB. And how does that work? Well, an IOA is a recipe containing side effects that in the end produces an A. So how do we get an IOB out of that? Well, we take the same recipe with the same side effects, but then before eventually returning the A, we apply the given function to it, and then return the result of applying this function to A to get the B. So as an example, if we import data.character from the standard libraries, we have the function toUpper, which converts a character into its uppercase version. So for example, toUpper small q, sorry, the character is not double quotes, it's single quotes, so toUpper q gives me the character capital Q. Now if I want to apply that to strings, I can use the map function on this, because strings in Haskell are just lists of characters. So if I map the toUpper function over a string, for example Haskell, then it gives me the string where now all the characters in this string have been converted to uppercase. Okay, so this map toUpper function is a function from string to string. Remember, string is just another name in Haskell for list of character. So that means I can use that in combination with fmap. So if I have fmap and as function from A to B, so in this case A and B are both string, and as function from string to string I use this toUpper, and then getline, I again get something of type IO string. So getline was of type IO string. The function I'm fmapping is from string to string, so I again get something of type IO string. And we can try that out and see it in action. So if I execute this in the REPL, it waits for user input. And if I now provide Haskell and press enter, we see that the result is now not just the string I entered, which would be the result of getline, but this function, this map to upper, has been applied to a result before returning it. So we get Haskell all capitals. So that's one way how we can take existing I/O actions and turn them into new I/O actions. The second way is provided by the by this character. I don't actually know how to pronounce it. Greater than, greater than. That just chains two I/O actions together, ignoring the result of the first. So for example, we can do put string line hello, and then this operator put string line world. And if we execute this, simply both actions will be performed in sequence. So I think it's called sequence, the operator. And in this case, the put string line only has a unit result, but of course this first one could also be a function that has a non-trivial result, but this operator simply ignores it. So given these two recipes, what the sequence operator does, it just basically sticks the recipes together. First performs all the side effects from the first recipe, then throws away the result, and then just attaches the second recipe. So that's one way. Then there is a very important operator which does not ignore the result of the first one, and that is called bind. So it's like this. And if we look at the type of bind, we see this monad constraint, but we can ignore that for now and just think of I/O. So what that says is, if I have a recipe that performs side effects and returns an A, and if I have a function that, given an A, gives me a recipe that returns a B, then these two can be combined to a recipe that produces a B. And how does that work? Well, if we have this IOA, we have a recipe to produce an A, so we can perform these side effects that will eventually give us an A. And then once we have this A, we apply this function here to that A and get a second recipe, now of type IOB, and we simply execute that and in the end get a B as a result. So as an example, I can apply this to getline and putString. That has exactly the right type. So getline is IO string, and then putStringLine has type string to IO unit. So if I combine these two with this operator, I get something of type IO unit. And what does it do? It will first execute the getline, which will return a string, then plug that string into putStringLine. So it will put the string line that was just entered out on the console. So to demonstrate, if I do this, get line, put, sorry, it must be bind, put string line. So now the get line is executed. If I enter Haskell, now this results in the string Haskell, which is passed on to put string line, and then put string line executes its side effects and writes Haskell to the console. There's another very important way to create I/O actions, and that is to produce recipes that immediately return a result without performing any side effects. And that is done with a function called return. So if I ask for the type of return, again, it's general for any monad, but we can just think I/O. So return has type A to IOA. So given an A, it produces a recipe that can contain side effects and eventually produces an A. And in the case of return, the recipe will simply not perform any side effects and immediately return the given A. So for example, I can do return Haskell. And now I have to give a type annotation because otherwise I wouldn't know what monad this is. So it's IO string and it immediately returns the string Haskell. Returning back to our main program using these operators that I just explained, we can now write relatively complex I/O actions. For example, I can define an I/O action that will ask for two strings and then write the result of concatenating those two strings to the console. So let's call that, I don't know, a bar. So it will have type IO unit. So what do I do? I do a get line to read the first string and I bind it to a function. And now I will use lambda expression. So I'll call the first element, read in element s. And now I format it a bit special, but in Haskell you have a lot of freedom when you format your code. So now I bind this to a second get line. And now I bind a third action. So let's call the result of this second get line t. And now, after I have this s and t, I do a put string line of s concatenated with t. I go back to the REPL. Okay, I just get a warning that it's defined but not used. So for example, I can, if I want to get rid of that warning, I can use bar here in main. Okay, now if I execute this new executable now with bar. So now it waits for the first input. So let's say one. Now it waits for the second input. Let's say two. And it returns, it doesn't return anything, but it writes the concatenation of the two to the console, one, two. So you see that using these handful of combinators, basically just the bind and the return, I can write arbitrarily complex I/O actions. And this is enough for us now for our purposes, because we won't really need the I/O monad. Maybe much later in the course when we talk about actually deploying Bluetooth contracts to the test net. But everything else, for everything else, we won't need I/O. But it's an important example of a monad, so I wanted to start with this. Now, for a while, let's completely forget about I/O and let's just write pure functional Haskell using the maybe type. So the maybe type, for those that don't know, is one of the most useful types in Haskell. So it's a type constructor that takes one type argument, and maybe A is often called something like optional in other programming languages. So it's an optional A. So there are two constructors for this type, nothing and just taking an A. So a maybe A can either contain an A with a just constructor or nothing. And let's import text read, sorry, read Ja, Text read. Read maybe. Right. In Haskell, if you want to pass a string to a value that has a read instance, that is normally done with the read function. So I can, for example, do read 42 and tell the compiler I expect an int, and it gives me, it passes the string 42 into the int 42. But read is a bit unpleasant because if I have something that can't be passed as a string, then I get an error. And that's not very nice. So that's why I imported this read maybe. Read maybe is very similar to read, but it in the case where pass is not possible, it will return a nothing. So if we replace this read with read maybe, and now the return type is maybe int, we get just 42. But if we again try that with something that can't be passed as an int, then we won't get an exception, we get a nothing. I created a new Haskell module called maybe. And let's say I want to implement a function. Doesn't matter, let's call it foo. That takes three strings and returns a maybe int. And the idea is that the function should try to pass all three strings as ints, and if that's successful, so if all can be successfully passed as ints, then I want to add those three ints and return the sum. And if one of the passes fails, I want to return nothing. So one way to do that, and I mean this is just plain elementary Haskell, so I try read maybe, I apply it to the first string, and now there are two cases. It could fail. So if I already can't pass the first string, then I can immediately stop. Then I don't even have to look at the other two. But if that succeeds, let's say that's k, I call that k, so it, k is now the integer that's passed from x, I can try to pass the second one. And again, I have two cases. This can fail, in which case the whole computation should return nothing, or there can be a successful pass, so I pass it as a just l, and now I can look at the third string, and again two cases, nothing, in which case I fail, or success. Let's call the result m. And now I have successfully passed all three int strings as integers. And now I can return just k plus l plus m. So I can try whether that works. So if I have foo 1, 2, 3. I get just 6. So this is passed as 1, this as 2, this as 3. All three passings succeed. So I can add 1 plus 2 plus 3 and get 6. But if one of those can't be passed, then I get nothing. And of course, if, sorry, I get nothing. Okay. But if we look at this code, we see that we repeat the same pattern three times. And it's always very similar. So we have something that is a maybe. This read maybe x, x, read maybe y, read maybe z. And then depending on the result, we always have to consider the two cases that it's nothing or just. And in the nothing case, we always fail with nothing, and in the just case, we carry on with the rest of the computation. And as Haskellers, we hate repetition like that and a lot of noise. So, I mean, the thing we want to do is very simple. We want to pass these three strings and add the result. But with all these cases and the always having to take care of the nothing case makes it very noisy and very ugly. So as a Haskeller, the natural tendency is to try to abstract away the pattern we have here. And one way to do that would be to define something like bind maybe, given a maybe A and the function from A to maybe B. We get a maybe B. And how would we implement this bind maybe? Well, if it's nothing, then we don't even care about the function. We immediately say nothing. But if it's just x and we have the function f, then we apply f to our x. And this is exactly what we did three times here. So to demonstrate the usefulness of this bind maybe operator, we can now write the same function again, our foo, but now using this bind maybe. Okay, so first we apply to read maybe x, and now we use bind maybe, and I write that in inline style to make it the pattern nicer. And if we successfully, so in the nothing case, nothing, this is now encoded here in this bind maybe. But if we succeed, let's call this k. So then I can do read maybe y. Use my new bind maybe again. And if it succeeds, I call the result L. And a third time. Call the result M. And in that case, I just do just K plus L plus M. Okay, now I can try the same things I tried before with foo prime, and I should get exactly the same results. So in the case where all three passes succeed, I get the sum, but if one of the three can't be passed, I get nothing. So we see that by introducing this bind maybe, we capture this pattern, this very common pattern that you often encounter when you use optional values of type maybe, that in the, if it's nothing, you want to immediately stop. It doesn't make sense to continue. But if it's just something, then using the value of this something, you can continue. And this is captured in this bind maybe function. And we see that using this, we can write the original foo function much nicer, in a much nicer form. So we don't have this dangling case statements any longer, and all this noise with the nothings, because this is now encapsulated, abstracted away in this bind maybe function. This does exactly the same as the foo did, but it's much more compact, and the business logic is much clearer. We see we try to read these three strings, pass them as ints, and if everything succeeds, we return the sum. So there's far less noise now by using this bind maybe function. And what that bind maybe does is it encapsulates the idea that we have something of a maybe type, and if that something is nothing, the overall result of the computation is nothing. And if it's just, then we continue with the value of this just. And if you think about it, that's a bit like exceptions in other programming languages. If you think of nothing as an exception, then the normal behavior of exceptions in other languages is that as soon as an exception is thrown, you immediately stop with the computation and return the exception or bubble the exception up. And this n this year now behaves very similarly. As soon as we encounter nothing, we immediately stop with nothing, and if not, we carry on. And this pattern, this idea, this exception-like behavior is captured in this bind maybe function. And using that, we can write the original logic very compactly. Another very useful type in Haskell is the either type that takes two type parameters A and B. So if I ask for information for either, then we see it has two constructors like maybe, but both carry value. So an either AB can either carry an A or it can carry a B, and the two constructors are left and right. So for example, I can have left Haskell, it can be of type either string int, but I can also have right 7 of the same type. I created another module where called either, where I basically just copied what we had for maybe. And if we take this exception analogy a little bit further, then one issue with maybe is that if we do nothing, so if we return nothing, in analogy to throwing an exception, then there is no error message. It's just nothing. It just fails without any indication of why. So if we want something like that, then we can replace maybe with an either type, where right corresponds to just and left corresponds to an error, like nothing did. But now we, depending on what type we choose for the first type parameter A, we can have a type of error messages. For example, we can use string. And the read maybe returns a maybe and not an either. So let's first define something. Let's call it read either. So read maybe has type read A string to maybe A. That would be the type of read maybe. But now let's replace this with an either string A. And we can implement this in terms of read maybe. So given a string, we just check what read maybe tells us about this string. So if parsing is not possible and we get a nothing, we can now return a left and pick some error message. This is now, it doesn't matter what we say, but I can say something like can't parse and just append the string, the given string. And if we can successfully pass to an A, then we return a write A. So we can try this out. So read either 42, either string int that succeeds, and we get write 42, where before with read maybe we got just 42. And if we pick something that can't be passed, then instead of just nothing, now we get a more informative error message. Can't pass this. Okay, and using that, we can now rewrite our foo in terms of either string int. So when we replace all the read maybes with read eithers. Now, of course, the cases change. Now, instead of nothing and just, we get left or right. So if we get left error message, well, we just stop with the same error message. And if we get right k, we continue. Same here. Left error message. Left error. And if it's a right, we continue. And once more, left error, left error. And if we get a right, we continue with right. This Oh yeah, that would compile, but okay, let's see. So let's try this out. So foo, what were examples if we have 1, 2, 3? We get right 6, but now if one of the arguments can't be passed, then okay, now maybe I should, I mean it's correct, but we don't see much, so if I write something, then now it doesn't simply fail. I get a nice error message, and if I have an error in one of the or something that can't be passed as an int in one of the other arguments, it works accordingly. And of course, we have the same problem again that we had with maybe, that we have these dangling case statements and a lot of repetition, a lot of boilerplate, because we always follow the same pattern. We always pattern match on the either, and in the left case, we simply return again the same left with the same error message that we got. So we immediately stop, don't continue, and instead return the error we got. And in the right case, we continue with the rest of the computation. And there's a similar solution again to what we did before. So let's call define a similar helper function that we call bind either. Where we replace each maybe with a either string, and now try to abstract away this pattern that we repeated 3 times here. So if we get left of an error message, we simply return left of the same error message. And if we got a right X, then we simply continue plugging X into the continuation of our computation. And now, in the same way as before, I can rewrite this foo in a much nicer form. I just have to replace each bind maybe with bind either. And of course, here I have to use read either instead of read maybe. And here, write. And now the same should again work if we use foo prime. So if all goes well, we get right, and if something can't be passed as an integer, I get a nice error message. And the same I said before is again true. So by introducing this little combinator, I abstract the pattern away that we repetitively used here. And the business logic becomes much clearer. And the code, incidentally, is very similar to what we had for maybe. It's almost the same, except that instead of bind either, bind maybe, I'm now using bind either. Instead of read maybe, I'm now using read either. So far, we have looked at 3 examples: IOA, maybe A, and either EA or either string A. And IOA represents plans that can involve side effects and when executed produce an A. And maybe A and either string A represent computations that can produce an A but can also fail. And the difference between maybe and either is just that maybe doesn't carry any error message, whereas either does. Now let's look at a completely different example that captures the idea of computations that can also produce log output. We can represent that with a type. Let's call it writer A. And let's just say it is a constructor that takes 2 arguments, an A, which is our result, but also a list of log messages. For simplicity, let's do it like this. Okay, and let's actually we can arriving show. And as an example, can define a function number from int to writer int. And given a number n, integer n, we just produce that number, and as log output, We just, it doesn't matter, but we can, for example, just say number and then show n. I can try that out in the REPL. So number 42 is, so we have the 42, the result, and this log message. And now let's do something similar as before. This foo function. So say we have three logging computations that each produce an int, and we want to compute those three computations to one that adds the three ints. So foo x, y, z, or let's pattern match, writer kx, writer ly, and writer mz. What can we do? So the overall result is k plus l plus m. And what should the log message be? Well, so we know each of the x, the y, and the z is a list of strings. So I probably should, rather following the Haskell convention for lists, call it x's, y's, and z's. And I can, for example, just concatenate those three lists. Okay. And I can try this also out. Let's say foo number one, number two, number three. And I get the expected result. So I get the sum as result, and I get these three log messages. Let's write another useful function. Let's call it tell, and it should just get a list of log messages and produce a writer unit. So one that doesn't have a useful result and just cares about the log messages. And I can just define that like so. Right, the compiler tells me I can write that simpler like this as well. And so I could make that this example a bit more interesting. I could add another log message. So let's say let s equals k plus l plus m, and write US equals tell sum show S. And now I can actually do it like this. And if I run the same example again, now we have an additional log message here that tells us the sum is 6, and we have the result. So the idea is we see we can again combine computations, several writer computations into a bigger computation. And the idea here is that we have to concatenate the log message from each computation in order to get the overall log message. And as before, we can write the function bindWriter. So given a writer that produces an A and a function from A to writer B, we can combine those to a writer B. What do we do? Again, I can pattern match against the first one. Okay, and how do I do that? Well, now I have the result A of the first computation, so I can plug this A into the function f to get a writer B. So I can say writer B y's equals f A. And now I can produce the result. So the result of the computation is B. And what are the log messages? Well, the xs from the first one plus the ys. And now using that, I can rewrite my foo using this bind writer. And make it much nicer. So I start with X, bind writer, call the result K, then Y, bind writer, call the result L. Z, bind writer, call the result M. Now tell some K plus L plus M. But actually, I should also, I can also use a let here. So let s equals k plus l plus m in tell sum is show s bind writer. And here I don't care about the result because tell doesn't produce a nice result. Now writer the sum and no you log message. Must remove the rest here. Okay, now what we did with foo before we can do with foo prime and we get the same result. And admittedly it's even longer now than it was before, so or at least not much shorter. But I think that it still is much nicer than the foo version. We don't have to do this pattern matching to extract the log messages from the three input computations. We don't have to explicitly combine the log messages, where we could make a mistake and forget one or get the order wrong. Instead, we basically abstract all of that away and can just concentrate on the business logic. And apart from this part here, where we use this additional tell, this is also very similar to, if you remember, what we did with maybe and either. So the code looks very much the same. So as before, we have this business logic. We have three computations, and we that somehow result in int, and we form the sum and return the sum. But note that the special aspect of these computations is completely different. In the maybe and either case, we captured the notion of failure, that something can go wrong. Whereas here in the writer case, there is no failure, but we have additional output, these log messages that we combine. So the bind maybe and bind either encapsulated the logic that if you want to combine two computations that might fail, and the first one fails, then the overall computation fails. Whereas if the first one succeeds, you can take the result to continue with the second computation. Here, the bind writer captures a different logic of sequencing computations, namely the logic that if you want to sequence two log output producing computations, you simply combine the individual log outputs. Now I think we are in a position to explain what a monad is. So going back at the four examples, what did they have in common? Well, we had a type constructor with one type parameter in every case. IO for real-world side effects, maybe for computations that can fail, either string for computations that can fail with an error message, and writer for computations that can produce lists of string as log output. And for all four of these examples, we had a bind function. So in the case of IO, it was this operator. It took an IOA and something A to IOB, and you can combine the two to an IOB. And we had very similar functions that we called bind maybe, bind either, and bind writer for our other three examples. And they always had the same shape. You take a computation of the type of computations you're considering, it results in A, and then a function from A to another such computation that results in a B, and you can bind the two together to a computation that results in B. And how this bind works depends on the case. In the case of IO, it's built-in magic, but you can think of it as just combining the two plans that describe the IO actions to take during execution. And in the bind maybe and bind either case, the logic is that if the first computation fails, then the combination also fails, but if the first computation succeeds, you continue with the second one. And in the bind writer example, the logic of bind was to just combine the lists of log messages from the two parts of the computation. And that is the main idea of monads. It's a concept of computation with some additional side effect. It can be real-world side effects, it can be failure or failure with error messages, it can be producing log outputs, and there are various other examples that I didn't mention. And the possibility to bind two such computations together. And how the bind works depends on the computation you're considering. There's another aspect that I briefly mentioned in the case of IO, but not for the other examples. Another thing that we can always do, whenever we have such a concept of computation with side effect, we also always have the possibility to produce a computation of this type that doesn't have any side effects. So I talked about return in the IO case. So given an A, you can turn it into an IOA, and that is simply the computation that immediately returns an A and has no side effects, no real-world side effects. In the case of maybe, we have the just constructor of maybe. So given an A, just A is of type maybe A, and it doesn't fail because it's not nothing. So it doesn't make use of the special possibility to fail. It doesn't fail. Same for the either case if we use the write constructor. So either string represents computations that can fail with the string error message, and if we use the write constructor, we have such a computation, but it doesn't fail. No error message, it has an A result. Finally, for writer, there is no short way to write it down. We could, for example, define a function, return writer or something, but I just wrote it down here as a lambda term. So given an A, we just produce writer A with an empty list of log messages. So given an A, we can produce a log message producing computation of type A that doesn't make use of this possibility to produce log messages and simply doesn't log and immediately returns the result. And the combination of these two features, the possibility to bind two computations together and the possibility to construct a computation from a pure value without making use of any of the potential side effects, this is what defines a monad. So if we look in the REPL and ask for monad, then we see the bind here. So in the monad class, we have this bind. So monad is now type constructor M. So where we have seen various examples, IO, maybe either string, writer. And we have this bind operator. So taking a computation that results in A and a way to turn A into a computation that results in a B, combine those two parts to a computation that results in a B, and the return that takes a pure value of type A and turns it into a side affecting computation, where the intuition always is that the M allows potential side effects, but in the return case it doesn't make use of this and just wraps this pure value into such a computation. We see here that we also have this operator that I explained in the case of I/O, but that can easily be defined in terms of the bind, so it's just given for convenience. And what it does is it just throws away the result of the first computation when it considers the second. So in other words, you can easily define it from bind by using the constant function here, the function that completely ignores its argument and always returns a fixed MB in order to, once we have bind, you also get this sequence operator. There's another technical computation. We see that Monad actually has a superclass applicative. So every monad is applicative, and if we ask what applicative is, we see it has a bunch of functions, but actually you only need the first two. And we see pure actually has the same signature, type signature as return. And then there's this one, which looks a bit more complicated. But the fact is, once we have return and bind in a monad, we can easily define pure and this operator that's called pronounced app. So pure is just return, and app there is actually a library function that automatically, given a monad, implements this. When we see that applicative in turn also has a superclass functor, and I mentioned that before also in the context of I/O, functor has this fmap class. Method. So given a function from A to B, we can turn an FA into an FB. The prototypical example for a functor is lists, and then fmap would just be map. So given a function from A to B and a list of A's, you can turn it into a list of B's by simply applying the given function to each element in the list. And we saw that we also have fmap for I/O. And again, once you have return and bind, it's easy to define fmap in turn in terms of return and bind. So there is a general pattern. So basically, you never, if you want to define a monad, you always define return and bind, and just to make the compiler happy and to also give instances for functor and applicative, there's always a standard way of doing that. So we can do this in the example of writer. So if I want to define a monad instance for my writer type, I need functor, applicative, and monad. But in almost all cases, you never do that explicitly. So I leave that open for now. So all you normally do is you define return and bind. So bind is just our bind writer, and return is the what I wrote there in the comment earlier. So we return by simply returning the A and giving empty list of log messages. Right. And given this, the standard way to implement functor and applicative is to use helper functions from the prelude from control monad. And there's something like lift m that always, so that basically makes use of return and bind to implement fmap. And for applicative, we need this pure, which we can just use return. And then we need this app operator. And there's something in similar to lift m, there's something called app in control monad that does that. Again, using return and bind, it implements this. So this is the standard pattern if you implement a monad. You implement return and bind, and then for the functor and applicative instance, you just use this these helper functions, lift m for pure, you use return, and for this app operator you use app, and that should compile. Right, so now we have by hand implemented a monad. I don't have to do the same for maybe either and IO because they are all already monads defined in the prelude. So there I don't have to do anything. And now that we have that, we can actually try to understand why this is useful. I mean, first of all, it's always useful in general to identify a common pattern and give it a name, just to name things somehow makes the importance of the concept clearer. And so it's always a good thing to identify that this is an important concept, an important pattern that happens all over the place, and then explicitly describe the pattern and give it a name. So that's one advantage. Second advantage is just that, I mean, we had to came up with all these names, bind writer, bind maybe, bind either. And now by using the type class, we don't have to remember all these different names for the different examples. We can always use return and bind. And finally, maybe the most important advantage is that there are lots of functions that don't care which specific monad instance we are dealing with. They just work for all monads. So we can write it once and for all monads, and then reuse it for specific examples. So both in the maybe and in the either and in the writer case, I had this thing where I took three computations that represent integers, and then I return the sum of them. And I can now, let's call it three ints, do that for all monads, once and for all. So I get an m int and an m int and a third m int and turn it into an m int. And mx, my, mz. And how do I do it? Well, I take the first one, call the result, for example, k, bind that to the second computation, call the result l, bind that to the third computation, call the result l. Now I can define the sum and now I can use the return of the monad to return the sum. I mean, I wouldn't need the let here. I could also do that inline, of course, which I basically did. And I can also do it like this. But for a reason that will become clear in a second or in a minute, let me leave the let here. And if we now look, if we go back, for example, to our maybe, we see this is now almost exactly the same code that I wrote here, except that instead of bind maybe, I'm now just using the bind operator that I have for every monad. So we can now rewrite this. If I import this, then I have the three ints function. So I can now write a third version of this foo. So now using the three ints function that I defined in the monad module, I can turn this into a one-liner, read maybe x, read maybe y, read maybe z. Trying it out. So foo 1, 2, 3. And again, I get just 6. And if one of those is not parsable, I get nothing. I can do exactly the same for either. If If I also import this 3ints function, so in this case it's 3ints read either x, read either y, read either z. And again, I can try it out. 1, 2, 3. And we get write 6. And if one of them is not parsable, I get a error message, appropriate error message. Writer is a little bit, I can't, because of this line here, because of this additional lock, it's not exactly the same. But if I am happy with not doing this lock, then it's even simpler because this is immediately an instance of the 3ints. So I must import the module. So that would work, but of course that's a bit cheating because now I don't have this, but I can get that as well. So I can simply use bind again. So if I want to do that, I do have to give the arguments. I see. Okay, so I get the sum as a result. And now I can do the tell sum show s. The tell doesn't have an interesting result, so I could write unit here, or I can simply ignore it, or I can use the sequence operator, which is made for exactly this case where I'm not interested in the result, and then return s. And again, if I run foo double prime, okay, sorry, I have to do number one, number two, number three, then again I get the same as before. So we see that now with this 3ints function that we defined once and for all for arbitrary monads, I can write all this specific code that I did for the various cases just reusing this function. So that's one of the biggest advantage of actually having this monad class. If you look into the control monad module in the standard Haskell Prelude, there are many, many useful functions that you can use for all monads. And so you have to write them once and for all in Haskell, and then you can reuse them over and over again. So let's go back to this monad module one last time. So yeah, the way I think about monads, it's a monad is some sort of computation with a side effect or a special feature or a special power. It's like a superpower. And so in the case of I/O, the superpower would be having real world side effects. In the case of maybe the superpower would be to be able to fail. In the case of either, the superpower would be to fail with an error message. And in the case of writer, the superpower would be to log string log messages. So you have this computation, you have a type that represents computations with some special features, some special power. And what turns this into a monad is the existence of return and bind. So return says you must have a way to, given a pure value A, you must be able to produce a computation of this type with return value A that does not make use of the superpower of the special feature. So it's an IO action that doesn't have any real-world side effects, or a potentially failing computation that doesn't fail, or a potentially logging computation that doesn't log. So that's return. It turns a pure value into such a value in that type of computations. And bind allows you to chain several computations of this type together. So giving two, I mean giving given one and a way to given a result of the first one, produce a second computation, you can use bind to bind those two together to one. And that is of course crucial if you want to assemble a large complicated computation. So you have like simple primitive ones, and using return and bind, you can assemble them into arbitrarily complex computations. And there is this slogan in the Haskell community that Haskell has an overloaded semicolon. And the explanation for this is that in many programming languages, in imperative programming languages, you write lines of code and at the end of the line you have a semicolon. And then basically what that does is it executes one after the other, and the different statements are separated by the semicolon. But what exactly the semicolon means, someone depends on the programming language. For example, there could be an exception, in which case computation or execution would stop at the spot where the exception happened and wouldn't continue with the next lines. Or there can be other things that could potentially happen. And in a sense, this bind is like a semicolon. So it binds different statements of monadic of computations together, like a semicolon does in an imperative language. And the cool thing about Haskell is that it's basically a programmable semicolon. So we can say what the logic is of binding two computations together, depending on the monad. Again, in the case of failure, the logic is that if the first computation fails, the whole thing fails. In the case of logging of writer, the logic is that you simply combine the list, the individual lists of log messages to a long concatenated list of log messages. So each monad comes with its own semicolon, basically, its own bind that tells you how to combine two computations. One last thing that needs to be mentioned is do notation. Because this is so common and monadic computations are all over the place, and we always have this pattern. So we do a bunch of monadic computations and we bind them together and give the result a name. There's special notation for this in Haskell that's called do notation. It's just syntactic sugar, so it doesn't add any more power to the language. You could write everything simply like this. But actually, how it would normally be written in Haskell would be using do notation. So let's write the same function again, but using do notation. And then this would look like that. So there is a do keyword. And then instead of writing it like this, this would be written like so. So, which has far less noise than this, but it means exactly the same thing. So the compiler will simply translate this do version into this. So whenever we want to bind and use the result, give a name to the result, we write it like this. So the computation is on the right of this arrow from the right to the left, and on the left is the name that we give to the result of this computation. And then we don't have to explicitly use the bind operator. We can just write a new line. And now in the following lines, the K and the L and the M will be available, so I can use it here for the return. And another thing you can do is let. So, oh yeah, I said earlier that I want to leave it like this. So I would do that like this. So you can also use let statements in a do block, and note that the in keyword that is normally needed in Haskell. So normally in Haskell, it's let in, But in a do block, you don't need the in. So, yeah. So, normally you would, in this case, instead of using explicit binds, you would use do notation. For shorter expressions, it's more or less a matter of taste. So, you can always use do notation, but you don't have to. And often, if it's like one or two computations, then people also use explicit binds. But as I said, it's a matter of taste. So, if we once more go back to our writer example. Let me just write this here in do notation instead, this foo double prime. So s goes here, then just the tell. Okay, and if I'm not interested in the result, I just can just write it like this. So I don't need the inverse error and the name if I'm not interested in the name, and just do it like so. And if I reload and run this again now with the do notation implemented with do notation, I get exactly the same result. So this is how one would normally write it. And that's monads for you. So hopefully now you have an idea how monads work, what they mean. And there would be a lot more to say about monads. So, for example, we have now seen examples how to do failure in pure code and logging and also I/O, not in pure code. I/O is not pure, but the other examples were all pure code. And how to use the monad instance of these examples to basically handle all of them uniformly using, for example, do notation or bind and return explicitly. But often, so we have these special features like failure with error message, logging messages, and so on. But often you are in a situation where you need several of these effects. So you want failure and log messages, for example. And that is also possible in Haskell. And there are a variety of approaches how to do that. One is called monad transformers. So with using so-called monad transformers, one can basically build custom monads using these transformers. So we can just say, I want failure and I want log messages. And then you use the monad transformer library to build a custom monad that has exactly the features that you want. But there are other approaches. One is called effect systems, which has a similar objective. So you basically want to tailor-make monads that have exactly the features you want them to have. And that is incidentally what Plutus uses for important monads, in particular the contract monad in the wallet, and also the trace monad that is used to test Plutus code. And the good news is that you don't have to understand effect systems to work with these monads. So it's enough. So, for example, to work with the contract monad that you use to define Plutus code that runs in the wallet, off-chain code, you must just know that contract is a monad, which, for example, tells you that you can use do notation. And you must know what special features this monad has. So, for example, in the writer monad, we have this tell function that's specific to the writer monad. And in the case of maybe or either, we can basically fail. So we have something like we can throw exceptions, which would be nothing in maybe or left in either. And similar, there is a list of things that you can do in the wallet contract monad. So all you have to know is basically how monads work in general, how you can chain statements or computations together using bind or do notation. And then for a specific monad, like the contract monad, the wallet monad, you have to know what specific features this specific monad offers. So that is what we will look at next. So we will look at the contract monad and see what this specific monad can do. Now that we hopefully all have at least basic understanding of monads and how to write monadic code, either by using explicit bind and return or by using do notation, we can look at a very important monad for Plutus, namely the contract monad. And maybe you have already seen that in the code examples I provided. So the contract monad defines code that will run in a wallet. So that defines the off-chain part of Plutus and is equally important to the on-chain part. But before we go into details with this contract monad, I also want to talk about a second monad, so-called emulator trace monad, because quite a few of you asked me whether we really need the playground to test Pluto's contracts and whether there's a like quicker, easier, and faster way that doesn't require you to start this playground server and then always manually copy-paste over into the editor and so on. And there is indeed, and this is done via this emulator trace monad. And you can think of a trace in this monad, a program in this monad, as what we do manually in the simulator tab of the playground. So there we always define the initial conditions and then a defined action. So we said wallet one does this invokes this endpoint with these parameters, and then we wait so and so many slots, and then wallet two does this, and so on. And things like that you can also do in this trace monad. So we should look at that first. And the relevant definitions are in the package Plutus contract in module plutus.trace.emulator. And basically, the most basic and most important function is called run emulator trace. It gets a so-called emulator config and then an emulator trace, so a computation in this monad. And it's a pure computation, so no I/O, no real-world side effects are involved. So it is a pure function and it basically executes this trace on an emulated blockchain and then gives a result, so a list of emulator events. Then maybe an error if there was an error in the emulator, and finally the final emulator state. And this emulator config is defined in a different module, but in the same package. It's in wallet.emulator.stream. And we see it only has one field, this record type, of type initial chain state. And initial chain state is either initial distribution or block. And the initial distribution in turn is in yet another module, same package, plutus.contract.trace, and it's just a type synonym for a map of key value pairs from wallet to value. So as you would expect, you just can specify for wallets what initial value they have. And value in Cardano is not just ADA or lossless, it can also contain native tokens. In the same module, if we scroll all the way down, we see there's also something called default dist, which gives a default initial distribution. And we see there's a variant default list 4 where we can specify wallets. So I think in the default distribution there will be 9 or 10 wallets. And here you can specify exactly which wallets. In the REPL, we can try this out. So if we import Plutus Trace Emulator and Plutus Contract Trace, then we, for example, have default distribution. We can just look at it. We see it's a map, so wallet 1, 2, blah, blah, blah. Until wallet 910, so it's 10 wallets, and each has an initial amount of 100 million lossless. Can also try out this default dist 4, and if we, for example, only specify one wallet in this list, we only get this one wallet that has initial funds, again with this value 100 million lossless. And if you want different initial values or also native tokens, then you have to specify that by hand. Okay, now we can run our first trace. So run emulator trace. So we need a config and the trace. And as we saw before, the emulator config just takes this initial chain state. So let's import wallet emulator stream as well. If we ask for this initial chain state, as we saw before, it's just an either initial distribution or a block. So if we therefore take our default distribution and use left, we should get an initial chain state. And if we apply emulator config constructor to this, we indeed get something of type emulator config. So we can now try it out with run emulator trace. Give this as default distribution. And now, of course, we need a trace. And the simple most trace we can possibly do is do the one that doesn't do anything and immediately evaluates to unit. So no actions whatsoever. And we see that even if nothing happens, we already get a crazy amount of data, which means that this run emulator trace function is not really useful for this, for trying out contracts by hand in the REPL. So it's mostly useful. If you want to make it useful, you must somehow filter all this data down to what is actually of interest to you and aggregate it in some way. Luckily, there are other functions. So here we have this run emulator trace. But if we scroll down, we see a very nice and useful one, run emulator trace IO, which just takes an emulator trace and runs it and dumps it in a nice form on the screen. And we don't even have to specify an emulator config as before, because by default we will just use what we now did, the initial distribution. So if we want to do that, we can remove this config here and just use run emulator trace IO. And we see a much more manageable and concise output. And this is now in IO, so it writes to the console. And I mean, nothing happens, but we see we have this initial genesis transaction and we see the final balances. And this shows these 100 Loveless that we saw before for the initial default distribution. If you want more control, there's also run emulator trace IO prime, which does take an emulator config. So we could specify a different distribution if we want, and it also takes a trace config. And if we look in this same module, what a trace config is, that has two fields. The first field specifies how events are displayed. So we saw when we used run emulator trace, we got many screens of data, and most of that data is these emulator events. And this function specifies which of those we want to print on the screen. So if for a given event we say nothing, it will just not be displayed. And if we say just a string, then that's the string we will see. And here's the default that is used by run emulator trace IO without prime. And we see most of the events are ignored and we only get output for some of those. The second field in this trace config is a handle, which by default will be standard out, so it will be printed to the screen. But we can also specify a file and if we want to lock the trace into a file. Now let's look at a more interesting trace. And I copied the contract from the last lecture, the vesting contract, into the code for this week. And I'm importing it here. And last week we tried it out in the playground. Now let's do the same in a trace. So I find a trace and I use do notation. So the first thing we have to do is what the playground does automatically, start the contract in all wallets that we are interested in. So we only need two wallets, so let's start it in wallet one and wallet two. And for that we have a function in this emulator trace monad, activate contract wallet, and it takes a wallet, so wallet one, and it takes the contract we want to activate, which was called endpoints. It's always called endpoints if you want to try it in the playground. Of course, we could choose another name if we are not worried with the playground. Now, this monadic function in emulator trace actually returns a value. It returns a so-called handle that we can then use with other functions to refer to this specific instance of this endpoints contract. So we use do notation and this bind. So we bind the result, the handle, to H1. Now we do the same for wallet 2. And now we can actually call an endpoint. So we can call the endpoint give on wallet 1, and that we can do with call endpoint. We have to specify which endpoint, and this uses some advanced type level Haskell. So the syntax is add, and now the name of the endpoint, give in our case. Now we have to specify the handle. So on which instance of the contract do we call this? We did that in the UI in the playground as well. I mean, we clicked on wallet one or wallet two, depending on where we wanted to do this. So let's do it on wallet one. And now we must specify the parameters, the values we give to this endpoint. So in the case of give, that was the give params data type, and that had three arguments, the beneficiary, the deadline, and the amount. The beneficiary should be wallet two, and it must be wallet two's pub key hash. And we can do that with pub key hash, wallet pub key, wallet two. Now the deadline, let's say slot 20, and the amount, let's say 1,000 Loveless. Okay, so this will call the endpoint. Now, for wallet 2 to grab it, for that to be successful, the deadline has to be reached. And in the another thing we can do in the trace monad, apart from activating contracts and calling endpoints, is also waiting, either for a number of slots or until a specific slot, similar to what we did in the playground as well. So that is wait until slot. So we can say until slot 20. And this will actually return a value, namely the slot we have reached. So in this case, 20. But we are not interested in that. And in order to avoid the warning, we can use void from data functor, which basically ignores the return value and turns it into a unit. And then we don't get a warning. Okay, now we want to call the grab endpoint on wallet 2. So that's grab. And the handle now is H2. And the parameters, the grab endpoint didn't take any interesting parameters, it was just unit. And finally, let's wait another slot to see the effect. And for that, we have wait n slots 1. In order to test that, let's define tests IO unit, and let's just use this ren emulator trace IO with the trace we just defined. Now in the REPL, I can invoke test, and we see our trace. So we see this is the Genesis transaction. And we see that we started these two instances for wallet 1 and wallet 2. So this is very similar to the trace output you also see in the in the playground. So here we invoked our give endpoint and the transaction was submitted and validated. Here we see a log that comes from the contract. So the log messages that we do inside the contract monad, inside the off-chain code, are actually well visible in this trace. Then now we reach slot 20 and the grep endpoint is called. Transaction is submitted, validated. We wait until slot 21 and we get the contract log message, collected gifts. And we also see in the final balances that indeed wallet 1 has 1,010 less. That is the 1,000 loveless gift plus 10 transaction fees. And wallet 2 has 990 more. So the 1,000 that it grabbed minus 10 transaction fees. Another thing we can do is we can also log from inside the trace monad. So for example, instead of ignoring the result here of wait and slots, I could give that a name, call it S, and then I can do log info reached slot S. And if we try this again, then everything is the same, except we have this line here, contract log, sorry, this one, user log, reach slot, get slot 21. So we see we can do logging both from inside the contracts, but also from inside our trace. Now let's look at the contract monad. The purpose of the contract monad is to define off-chain code that runs in a wallet. And we notice it has four type parameters, W, S, E, and A. The A is the same as in every monad. It just denotes the result type, the result, overall result of the computation. Just briefly, we will go into all three, W, S, and E, in more detail later. So the W is like in our writer monad example. It allows you to write log messages of type W. In our example, we had just list of strings. The S describes the capabilities, the blockchain capabilities. So what blockchain-specific actions this contract can perform. That will normally always include things like waiting for a slot, submitting transactions, finding out my own public key. But it can also contain specific endpoints. And the E describes the type of error messages. So you can throw and handle exceptions in this contract monad, and the type of error messages is type E. Let's look at that first, and let's write an example. My contract. So let's say we are not interested in writing any logs, and for S, the minimal plausible choice is called blockchain actions. There's a type called blockchain actions, and that will give us access to all the things I mentioned, waiting for a slot, submitting transactions, and so on. The only thing we can't do if we just use the type blockchain actions here is handling endpoints. So if we want to use specific endpoints, we must use a different type there. Okay, and for error message, a popular choice is text. Text is a Haskell type for textual data, like string, but it's much more efficient than string. And we don't want a specific result. And let's start by simply doing, let's just log a message. So log info, hello from the contract. We must qualify this with contract because we also have log info available in the trace, in the emulator trace monad. And so we qualify it that we mean the contract monad version. And now it's still complaining. And this is caused by this extension I activated, overloaded strings. As I explained before, by default in Haskell, without that extension, if you have a literal string and double string and double quotes, that is just a string. But using this overloaded strings extension, you can use literal strings and double quotes also for other textual data types like text. So in this case, the compiler is confused because it doesn't know whether we mean a string here or text or something else. That's why I activated the second extension as well, type applications. That allows me to use the at symbol and the type, for example, string, to tell the compiler at what type I'm invoking this here. So now I say, okay, this is a string. Okay, now let's define a trace that starts this contract in a wallet. Also call it one. And let's just, all this trace does is it activates the contract for wallet one and ignores the handle. So we don't do anything with the handle. Okay, and now I can test one. Run emulator trace IO my trace one. And of course, this now has nothing to do with error messages. So if I run test one, we just get this log message, hello from the contract. Okay. Now let's throw an exception. So let's turn this into a do block. And before the log, let's throw an exception. Can do that with contract throw error. And now the type of the error message is this E. And in our case, I pick text. So now I must give a text as error message. And I can use, as I said, literal strings because of this overloaded string extension. And now I get a warning that I'm ignoring the result. So let's use void again as before to say I don't care about the result. Okay, and if I now reload this, do test one again, then we don't get the log message any longer. And instead, we get a message here, contract stopped with error, and we get the error message, boom. So this behaves as expected. So execution of this monadic computation stops as soon as an error happens or an exception is thrown. So we never get to this log info. Another thing you can do is handle exceptions. So let's do a second example. Let me just copy all of this. Let's call that contract two. And this time, instead of text, I choose void. Void is a Haskell type that has no inhabitant. There's no value of type void. So if we say we have error messages of type void, that means there can't be any errors. Because for there to be an error, there would need to be an error message of type void, but there's nothing of type void. So this indicates this will be a contract that can't fail. And how do we do that? So the idea is I want to invoke contract one, but handle the error. So I use contract handle error. And we see the type is. So this will be the contract that whose errors we handle, the second argument. And the first argument is the handler. So given an error message, it produces a new contract with W, S, and A the same as of the original contract, but we can change the error message. So in our case, the E would be text. And the E prime would be void. So let's do that. So I must handle the error message. So I can do whatever I like. For example, I can just log, let's use log error this time. And now I want to give a string. And let's say caught or handled. Let's say caught error. And I want to give the error message, but now this caught error is a string and the error message is a text, so I can't compose them, but there's a function unpack in data.text that converts a text to a string. So by converting this error message to a string, I can concatenate it with this literal string caught error. So that's my handler, and now I can use my contract one here. Let's just adopt this to contract 2. If I now try test 2, I don't get this error message anymore. So the contract didn't fail. And now I get this log message that comes from the handler called error boom. But note that we still, of course, don't get this log message here, hello from the contract. As before, now in this second example, if we run this my contract one, execution will stop here when the error is thrown. But this will now no longer result in overall error because now the handler takes over and instead we get this caught error message. So that's how to throw exceptions and catch exceptions in the contract monad. Of course, exceptions can also happen if they are not explicitly thrown with throw error, but for other reasons. So there are certain operations, for example, submitting a transaction. And the way that works in Plutus is that we declaratively specify certain conditions that our transaction should satisfy. So, for example, we can say this transaction should pay 1,000 ADA to a certain address. And if we try to submit that, but if in our own wallet we don't have sufficient funds to turn this into a transaction because we don't have large enough inputs, then we would get an exception at that point when we try to submit error. Next, let's look at the S parameter, the second one that determines the available blockchain actions. So in the first two examples, we just use the blockchain actions type, which, as I explained, has all the standard functionality you would expect how to interact with the blockchain, but doesn't have support for specific endpoints. So if you want an endpoint, we must use a different type. And the pattern that's normally done is that we define a type synonym, then so-called schema. So it will always be these blockchain actions, and then we can add endpoints that we want with a so-called type operator. So this operator doesn't operate on values like plus or double plus for concatenate. It operates on types. So we can add certain other types now that define the endpoints. But in order to do that, we need two more extensions. One is data kinds, and one is type operators. Okay, and with that, now we can add an endpoint. So first, we use a type level string, the name of the endpoint, let's call it foo, and then the second argument is the parameter type. So what value this endpoint takes. Let's just use an int, or yeah, why not? Okay, and now we can use this type to define our contract. So my contract 3 is now contract. Let's say again, we don't write. Now, instead of just blockchain actions, we use my schema. So we also can use this foo endpoint. And let's use text error messages and no result. My contract 3. Now we can use endpoint. So endpoint gives us a contract WSEA. And this has endpoint constraint means that the endpoint, the A must be the same as there. So in our case, we have an endpoint that takes an int parameter. So we will get a monadic computation that gives us that int. So in the way it works, so I can, for example, bind the result n to the result of endpoint. Now I must specify which endpoint. So I give this type level string here. Okay, and now, so this will block, this contract will block until this endpoint is invoked from the outside with an integer in our case, or an int. And then, so it will block until then, and then it will continue, and n will be bound against the provided int. So to try it out, we can just say something like log info n contract. Okay. Now let's test this. So now it's no longer enough to simply activate the contract, because as I said, that would just block. So now we must also invoke the endpoint if we want to try it out. So we need the handle. And we have seen that before with call endpoint. So I again have to specify what endpoint, so foo. And now I must give the handle, so that's the age, and now the parameter. In our case, must be an int, so for example, 42. And that should do that. And now write the test for this. And we see it worked. So here we have receive in endpoint call with the 42, and we also see the log message. So the endpoint was successfully invoked with 42 as parameter, and then this 42 became available in the contract. Finally, let's look at the first type parameter, the writer. And so this W can't be an arbitrary type, it must be an instance of the type class monoid. This is a very important, very common class in Haskell, and it has mempty and mepend. Mempty is something like the neutral element, and mepend combines two elements of this type to a new element. The prime example of a monoid is lists, where mempty is the empty list and mepend is concatenation. So, for example, I can say mempty list of ints, and it will be the empty list, and I can use mepend 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and it will combine them. But there are loads and loads of other instances of this monoid type, and we'll probably see other instances in this course. But for now, let's stick with lists. So let's write our last example, my contract 4, where we now don't use unit here, but instead list of ints. We don't need my schema, we can just use blockchain actions again. And the way we do it, let's start with the wait. Let's wait 10 slots. And suppress the warning by adding void info. And now let's write to this log, and we do that with tell. And then, so let's write the list that contains one, and let's wait for another 10 slots and write two, and let's wait for another 10 slots. Now for the trace, to see that indeed while the contract is running we have access to this log state, we activate the contract as before. Now we wait of, let's say, 5 slots, so that should still be before we do the first tell. And how do we access the state? We can do that with observable state, and as it's only argument that takes the handle, and the result will be the state. So in our case, a list of ints. And we can lock that. Oh yeah, and here, if we use void, we suppress the warning that we don't care about the current slot. Okay, let's do that two more times. Let's wait 10 slots. Let's call the result y. And once more, again waiting 10 slots, call the result z's. I need to test as well. try it out. Okay. And we see that the first time we call this observable state, no tell has happened yet. So we still have the mempty, the empty list. Now here at slot 10 or so, the tell happens. So the next time we invoke in observable state from our trace monad, we get the 1. And the second time, the 2 has also been written. So now the total log is the 1 and the 2. And we get that. So this shows how we can communicate back from the contract to the trace. And as we will see later, more importantly, also to the PAB, the Pluto's application backend. So using this mechanism, it's possible to pass information back from the wallet, from the contract running in the wallet to the outside world. So we have bidirectional communication using endpoints. We can pass information into a contract, and using this lock tell mechanism, we can get information back out of a contract. For homework, please look at the following contract that I wrote. I called it pay contract, and as schema, it uses pay schema, which has blockchain actions as always, and one endpoint called pay with pay parameters. Pay parameters are defined here. It takes a recipient, which is a public key hash, and an integer, which is supposed to be the amount of lufflers. And what this contract does is simply send to this address that many lufflers. So let's look at how it works. So first I call the endpoint action at the pay endpoint. So I get the parameters as a result. So it will block until this endpoint is called, and then I will get the parameters as a result. Then I use one of the constraints from ledger.constraints, must pay to pubkey, that tells the contract I want a transaction that has an output to this pubkey hash with this value, so lufless value of what is specified in the parameters. And then we can use a simple version to submit a transaction. This is enabled because we have blockchain actions available in our schema. So what this will do is it will try to balance the transaction. So I only specified that I want this output to the recipient. So this here will take care of finding a suitable input to balance this transaction so that the input value equals the output value, and it will take care of the fees and then submit the transaction to the blockchain. And then I recursively call the same contract again so that you can call the same pay endpoint as often as you want. So what I would like you to do first is implement a trace, an emulator trace, that takes 2 integers as parameters. And the idea is that this trace should run the pay contract on wallet 1 and twice send money to wallet 2. And the amounts of lufflers to send are the X and the Y. So it should send X lufflers first, then wait for 1 slot, then send Y lufflers, then wait for another slot. So that's the trace. And then I have 2 test ones where the 2 amounts are 1 million lufflers and 2 million lufflers, and the second one where the amounts are 1 billion lufflers and 2 million lufflers. If we try the first one, then it should succeed. So we see twice this endpoint is invoked, and in the end we see that wallet 2 has 3 million lufflers more than before, 1 million plus 2 million. However, if we try the second test, this pay test 2, then because wallet 1 doesn't have 1 billion lufflers, there will be an exception in this line 32 with submit transaction because it can't be balanced. There is no input large enough to balance the 1 billion lufflers output. So that means that in this trace, after the first invocation of the endpoint, there will be an exception and this contract will stop. So the trace will never get to the second one. So the second thing I want you to do is modify this pay contract to handle the error so that if the submit transaction fails, the contract shouldn't crash. It should just log an error message. And after doing that, then we would see something like this. So after the first one, we see maybe an error message, a log message that an insufficient funds wallet error was caught. And then the second pay just works. So the end result is that this 1 billion transfer is just ignored and the 2 million transfer still happens. So that's the two things you should do. Implement this trace function that does these two invocations of the pay endpoint and then modify the pay contract so that it doesn't crash when the submit transaction goes wrong.